وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
قال له عمر رضي الله تعالى عن عمر then said to the Prophet فإنه الآن now والله لأنت أحب إلي من نفسي now you are more beloved to me than my own self. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم then the Prophet said الآن يا عمر عمر now now you have completed your iman. So this claim that I love the Prophet and I give presents to him is not a mere claim. This is what we have to truly understand. Many of us, if you were asked today, is the Prophet most beloved to you than yourself? You'd say, yes, I do. I love him. Alayhi salatu salam. So this is not, brothers, ليست مجرد دعاوى يدعيها المرء. It's not a mere claim that a person just claims. Because it's easy. لأنه من السهل على كل اللسان. Every tongue, everyone can say that. That's simple. It's the easiest thing that a person can do. But what is it that we will do? What we need to do is to put that love of yours, which you've claimed, to the test, right? And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He sent an ayah that tests the person's claim of that which they love. If they pass this test, then their claim is right. And if not, then their claim is, it is from the mere claims that are out there. What is it that the Prophet Allah says in the Quran? قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ If you love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي follow me, يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ Allah will love you, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ And Allah will forgive you for your sins, وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ And Allah تبارك وتعالى is one who forgives the shortcomings and the errors of his slaves. Hassan al-Basri, he said, اِدَّعَ قَوْمٌ مَحَبَّةَ اللَّهِ A group of people came out and they claimed the love of Allah. فَبَتَلَاهُمُ اللَّهُ بِهَذِي الْآيَةِ Allah tested them with this ayah. What did Allah test them with? Allah tested them with this ayah. Many people, brothers and sisters, they love Allah on a normal day. On a normal day where they enjoy themselves and everything. They say good things and they're happy and they say, MashaAllah, Allah loves me, I love Allah. Allah said in the Quran, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٌ اطْمَأَنَّ بِهِ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٌ انْقَلَبَ عَلَى وَجْهِ خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينُ There's a group of people, they worship Allah على حرف on the edge. فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٌ اطْمَأَنَّ بِهِ If good comes his way, he's calm, he's tranquil, he's enjoying himself, he's smiling, Allah loves me, Allah, I love Allah, that's it. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٌ When calamity is hit him, trials and tribulation is put towards him. انْقَلَبَ عَلَى وَجْهِ This person turns backwards. خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ This person is upon great misguidance and great loss. ذَلِكَ وَالْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينُ Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He told us that there is a group of people who made the love of Allah and His Messenger equal to the others. Allah says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِذْ يَرَوْنَ الْعَذَابَ أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعَقَابِ إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ اتُّبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا وَرَأَوُا الْعَذَابَ وَتَقَطَّعَتْ بِهِمُ الْأَسْبَابُ وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا لَوْ أَنَّ لَنَا كَرَّةً فلتبرأ منهم كما تبرأوا منا كذلك يريهم الله أعمالهم حسرات عليهم وما هم بخارجين منها Allah tells us in this ayah there are a group of people who what وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ They love them like they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ But the true believers they love Allah more than anything Who affirmed the love for the believers? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because brothers, the believers, their love is not just a claim. It's not just a claim. What is their love? Their love is actions. Their love is a reality. When the time comes and it's needed to be seen, they're not going to pave it away. They're not going to leave. They're right next to the Prophet. And they're right next to the religion and they're defending it. A lot of people claim Islam on the glory days. The times of hardship when you see the munafiq from the believer. Sahih? The battle of Uhud that I mentioned a couple of weeks ago, Khutbatul Jum'ah, in this masjid. When the Prophet ﷺ, Quraysh chose to come out, and they chose to leave Mecca, because Quraysh were preparing for a whole year for the battle of Uhud, right? After they lost Badr, that year straight away they started to prepare. Ridalik, the caravan that succeeded for them after that journey from Badr, because the battle started because of the caravan, right? When that caravan made it to Mecca, Abu Sufyan was not in the Battle of Badr, was he? Now his job was to protect the qafila to Quraysh, the caravan of the people of Mecca. So who died? The Sanhadid of Quraysh, the leaders of Quraysh died. Abu Jahl died, Utbah died, big men, Umayyah ibn Khalaf, they all passed away in the battle, got killed in the Battle of Badr. So when Quraysh came, the children of these Ikrimah and others were the children of who? They were the children of who? Abu Jahl and others. They came back to Medina, Mecca. They tell Abu Sufyan, listen, has this caravan made it to Medina? Mecca? Has this caravan made it back to Mecca? Abu Sufyan, he said, yeah, of course it did. They said, everything on this caravan now is not going to be used for anything except to prepare for the war. They're going to prepare. So all of the merchandise and everything and the money and everything that was on that caravan, they used it to prepare for the army. Money they put in it. A whole year these men were getting ready. The whole year. Because Ramadan, the Battle of Badr was when? It was in Ramadan, the second year, the 17th of Ramadan, right? Second year of Hijriah. It took place on the 17th of Ramadan. And the Battle of Uhud took place the month of Shawwal, the third year of Hijriah. The different three qawl, some said 11, some said 15, some said 6. Different aqwal. What day it was, there's a khilaf. But the ijma' is that it's Shawwal and it's the third year of Hijriah. So it's a 1 year difference, and 1 year and 1 month, right? Quraysh were preparing. Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard the Quraysh were making their way, he heard they're gonna come, they're making their way to what? Medina. They're making their way from Mecca to Medina. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told, for he led the Salatul Jum'ah, he finished the Salatul Jum'ah, he turned and finished, and then went to lead the janazah, the Prophet. There was a man from the companions who died, the Prophet led the janazah, he turned around to his people and he said, listen, O companions, what do you guys see that we should do today? Abdullah ibn Ubayy ibn Salul, the Ra'is al-Munafiqin put his finger up and he said, I have an advice. What is it? O Messenger of Allah, we should fight for Medina. The Prophet liked that idea. He said, I think what Abdullah ibn Ubayy is saying is good. Anyways, the overwhelming majority said, Ya Rasulullah, let's go out. Look at the quwwah and the iman of the Ansar. Look at the quwwah of Muhajirin. Look at the quwwah of the Sahabas and their true love for this religion. What did they say? There was a noble companion. His name was called Malik al-Ansari, rahimahullah. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, la tuharrimni, don't prevent me from entering Jannah. I did not participate in the Battle of Badr. I wasn't there. I wasn't alive. I wasn't able to fight then. Or because he came into Islam late. I wasn't there. I now see the opportunity of Jannah. Don't prevent me from it. Sah. He said to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, I don't think we should fight in Medina. I think we should go out there. Whatever the number is, Ya Rasulullah, we're going to fight. The Prophet said, okay. He got up, he went into his room, he put on his armor, he came out. When he came out, they said, before the Prophet came out, fima baynahum, amongst themselves, they started to converse and said, look, wallah, we pressured the Messenger of Allah into this decision. He didn't want it. He wanted to fight in Mecca, in Medina. This was his decision. We have now come and we've clouded the Prophet's decision. We've discussed, we've pressured him into it. He did not want to do this. So when he comes, we'll say, oh, Messenger of Allah, we're sorry, we'll fight in Medina, in the city as you wanted. And the reason why the Prophet went to the city is because the city, the roads that are coming are very narrow. And if they're large in number, their number is not going to matter now. Because the people who are large in number, they need to spread out. If they all narrow themselves on one road, it's easy for them to be destroyed with arrows. And he said that the city is ours, so we can go on every little corner, every little hill, every benefit from it like that. Anyways, the Prophet, by the time he came out, they said, O Messenger of Allah, we're sorry, we apologize, we're now going to fight in Medina. Look what he said to them, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said to them, Wallahi, He said, لَا يَنْبَغِي لِنَبِيٍّ إِذَا لَبِسَ لَأْمَتَهُ. It is not befitting for a messenger after he puts his armor on, for him to take it off unless he sees the enemy and he fights with them. That's the way that a prophet is. He can't just take his armor off now. It's too late. We have to now go to the enemy. So the Prophet ﷺ prepared everybody. He gave Mus'ab ibn Umayrin the raya, because he was from Abdiddar. He said, look, you're the lead, hold the banner. He organized the companions. He took some of the companions, like Abdullah ibn Jubayr, he placed him on top of the mountain, and 50 men and Arab men. He said, you guys be here and everything. He sorted everything out, alayhi salam. But on the way, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul took 300 of the companions away. 300 men, sorry, from the Prophet. 300 men. And he said, لَكُنَّا نَعْلَمُ قِتَالًا لَتَّبَعْنَاكُمْ. Look at the munafiq. He's always seen this time. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ. What did he do? He took 300 men from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And then not only that, two noble groups of companions from two powerful tribes, Bani Salama and Bani Haritha. Both of them even intended to leave. Allah says in the Quran, إِذْ هَمَّ الطَّائِفَتَانِ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ تَفْشَلَ وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّهُمَا وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. There were a group of companions, two big large tribes. These were the tribes that Jabir ibn Abdullah was from. And Jabir said, Fina nazala hadhihi al-ayah. This ayah came down on us. That this ayah, إِذْ هَمَّ الطَّائِفَتَانِ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ تَفْشَلَ وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّهُمَا. But he said, I'm so happy that this ayah came down on us. Why? Because he said, Allah said in the ayah, وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّهُمَا. Allah is their ally. Bani Haritha and Bani Salama. Both of them, Allah is there. He's their ally, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's true, they didn't leave. Because Allah made them firm. They thought about it, their decision. And they said, how can we leave the Prophet of Allah today that he needs us? Look at the believer. His iman shakes in. This is what shows you that it wasn't a claim. It wasn't mujarrad da'awa. He's got thabat and quwwah. They stood by the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Knowing they just lost 300 men. And guess how much the companions were after? Their effort was put in to gather them together. How much are they now? Were they? They were 1,000 men. They were 1,000 men. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul took 3. How much is left now? 700 men. Seven after struggle, 1,000 they reached. Kufar of Quraysh, they divided their men into two sides. The right side and the left side. They gave the right side to 200 men. They gave the right side to who? Ikrimah. And the right left side, Khalid. And they divided them like that. They said, you guys go. And they directed them towards where the companions were on the mountain. The point and I'm trying to come to is that, ya ikhwa, these people, if you look at the battle of Badr and how it took place, every struggle Islam went through, what did the Sahabas they say to us? Look what Ansar said to the Prophet ﷺ. لا نقول لك كما قالت بنو إسرائيل لموسى. We're not going to say to you what بنو إسرائيل said to Nabi Allah Musa, اذهب أنت وربك فقاتلا إنا هاهنا قاعدون. We're not going to say that to Muhammad, that you and your Lord go and fight. We're not going to say that to you, Rasulullah. That's what, no, we're not going to say that to you. We're going to say to you, idhab anta wa rabbuk. You and your Lord fight, fa inna ma'akuma muqatilun. We are with you fighting. So look at the difference between the followers of Musa and the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The difference between the two and the statements that came from them. Sah. If you look at the battle of Uhud, how the companions, you know, the battle took place, the mukhalafa to amri Rasulillah, the Prophet was opposed, alayhi salatu was opposed. And the companions, when he told them, don't come down from that mountain, they did come down, right? Because of the fact that they saw spoils of war. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said something very powerful, because the ayah came down, Allah says, minkum man yuridu dunya wa minkum man yuridu al-akhirah, thumma sarafakum anhum liyabtariyakum wa laqad afa ankum. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, I never thought from amongst us, the companions, there were those who wanted the dunya. I never thought that, he said, Ibn Mas'ud. I never thought within us, until this ayah came down, minkum man yuridu dunya wa minkum man yuridu al-akhirah. He said, I never thought amongst the companions of the Prophet, there were those who wanted the dunya. Never thought that. These sahabas, this didn't enter their hearts. It was the furthest from their hearts. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's companions, their iman was tested and it was put to the test and they passed it. So the iman, ya ikhwat al-kiram, and the love of the messenger is not mujarrad al-da'awa. It's not a mere claim. It's not something we just say. And then when we're found, the times when it's jid and ijtihad, the times of hardness and the times of toughness, when we're looked at, we're not there. We're missing from that circle or we're missing from that place. Ya ikhwat, that's not. And the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his sunnah and everything is what? It's present on you. Wallahi, one of the powerful things was that Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen was diagnosed with cancer. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. When he was diagnosed with cancer, they told him, the doctors, they said, Sheikh, we're going to have to do chemotherapy on you. You're going to have to do chemotherapy. And when they said to him, you're going to do chemotherapy, they told him what's going to happen in the treatment and how is it going to be. And then, you know, the chemotherapy, what does it involve? Your hair flying off. And then the Sheikh said, what about my beard? They said, Sheikh, even your beard's going to go. He said, I don't want to meet Allah without a beard. I don't meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the day of judgment with no beard. No. Sheikh died because of that. Throat cancer. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wa sa'ila. Iddan ijtihad. They were serious about their deen. Now it's chemo. It will kind of freeze this cancer. It will make you, you know, your things will be smooth. Your life will be better for a period of time. In the Sheikh rafa dhalik. Why? Because this is sidq. Allah says, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَنْ يُتْرَكُوا أَنْ يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Do you think Allah will not distinguish between who's truthful about this iman and who's lying about it? The person will be tested. Allah wants to see who's saying the truth and who is what? And who's lying. All of that has to be put. It has to be put to the test. رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ رَحْمَةً وَاسِعَةً. And wallahi, brothers, I'll tell you something. You can only be steadfast and you can only be in love of the Prophet and be the one that you want to be if you're like that at the times of ease. Then you can be in the hard times of hardship. You prepare yourself and you nurture yourself at the times when you're in the glory days of your life and the times of ease and simplicity and fun. If you hold up to that deen and you're real about it, wallahi, brothers, by Allah, wallahi, when the time comes, hardship hits, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna Allah la yudu'a ajra man ahsana amala. Allah will not forsake you. The good that you did here will come an intercessor for you and it will bring you through the calamities and the hardship that you're going through. So this is powerful, ya ikhwah. Mahabbat al-Rasul, loving the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. There's a point I wanted to mention. When the battle of Uhud happened and the companions all dispersed and of course they ran away, 9 men came back to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. How many men? Everyone ran away from him. The Prophet called, Ya ayyuhan nas, ilayya. The Prophet said, oh people, come back to me. Come back to me. I'm the messenger of Allah. Don't leave me in the battlefield. So they came back to him. 9 managed to make it. 7 of them were Ansar. 2 of them were Muhajirin. Wallahi, if you look at and you read the way that they defended the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in that battle, and the way they put their chests out, 7 of them, he sends them and he says, do this, they will do it. All 7 of them died before they made him reach the mountain alayhi salatu wasalam. Ya iqra'u tariq al-sahaba. Read their biography and then you will realize what real love is. Then you realize what true love was. Point number 2. أن تتخذه إماما لك في عباداتك. That you take the Prophet as your imam in ibadah. وأخلاقك in your manners. بحيث تستحضر عند فعل العبادة أنك متبع له. That you bring in your heart, that when you're doing an act of worship, أَنَّكَ مُتَّبِعُ لَهُ, that you are in accordance to him. وَكَأَنَّهُ أَمَامَكَ, and like he's in front of you. تَتَرَسَّمُ خُطَاهُ وَتَنْهَجُّ نَهْجَهُ, and you're taking his footsteps and you're treading on his path. Like he's in front of you and you're following him like that. Footsteps. He puts his foot up and then you put your foot right where he took his foot from. وَكَذَلِكَ فِي مُخَالَقَةِ النَّاسِ, and also in the way that you deal with the people and your mannerisms towards the people. أَنَّكَ مُتَخَلِّقٌ بِأَخْلَاقِهِ الَّتِي قَالَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا, that your etiquette and your character and your mannerism is in accordance to how he was عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Prophet, in which Allah said about his situation and his affairs, وَإِنَّكَ يُوْ أُوْ مُحَمَّدْ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, you're of great mannerism, you're of great character and etiquette. وَمَتَى الْتَزَمْتَ, and whenever you are, brothers, بِهَذَا, if you are like that, you're in accordance to what, brothers? You follow him in his ibadah. You follow him in his etiquettes. You follow him in everything. فَسَتَكُونُ حَرِيصًا غَايَةَ الْحِرْصِ عَلَى الْعِلْمِ بِشَرِيعَتِهِ وَأَخْلَاقِهِ. You will then, brothers, you will then strive greatly in knowledge of his sharia and his mannerism. If you look at what Allah said in the Quran, that supports the statement of the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, is Allah said in the Quran, لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. Allah tells us in the ayah, that in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a what? A great example. Many people say to you, the youngsters nowadays don't have role models, and that is not true. That is not true to say that. They have the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is a true role model for them, alayhi salatu wasalam. And anyone who ponders on the verse realizes the power of how Allah spoke here. Allah did not say, the Prophet is a role model for you all in his etiquette, or he's a role model in his ibadah, or he's a role model. No. Allah says that the Prophet is a role model in and within himself. He said in the ayah, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ, in the Prophet. There's a role model in him. So that means everything that comes from him is an example for you that you need to follow him in, alayhi salatu wasalam. And the thing that's needed from us all, ikhwah, is to follow him in his ibadah as much as we need to follow him in his etiquette, alayhi salatu wasalam. If you complete ibadah and you haven't completed the etiquettes that the Prophet came with, then there's deficiency in you. Ahlul ilm, the people of knowledge, they didn't belittle the concept of etiquettes and mannerism. That's why you find books of aqaid, at the ending they mention it. Sah? The kitab aqid to al-wasatiyya, what's the ending? Etiquettes and mannerism, he talks about it. After he talks about aqid and tawheed, at the ending. So it's no point believing in the articles of faith and coming with the iman and coming with aqidah ahli sunnah wal jama'ah and bab al asma' wal sifat and bab al asma' wal ahkam and masail al qada' wal qadar and al wa'd wal wa'id and al sahaba, and then you have deficiency in the etiquettes and the way you carry yourself. Allah said to the Prophet, wa innaka la'ala khuluq al 'azim, Muhammad, you are of great character. Sah? What did the Prophet say? Bu'ithtu, I was sent out as a messenger. This is my job, this was my mission. I was sent. Bu'ithtu li utammima makarim al-akhlaq. I was sent to complete good etiquettes. Bu'ithtu, this is the purpose in which I was brought out, to complete the good etiquettes in the people. Walidhalika, it's sad, wallahi, it's extremely sad when we find Muslims who are supposedly meant to be practicing, when you find them have the lowest and the weakest of etiquettes. Huh? Akhlaq is raleel. The way they speak, the way they talk, the way they deal with people, the way they react, the way they act, all of it. You're shocked to what you see from them. And it makes it even worse when it's meant to be brothers who are meant to be practicing, who got lihya, who understood manhaj Ahli Sunnah. They've understood manhaj Salafiyah. And you see bad etiquettes from them. It's shocking. Did you just think that following the Prophet ﷺ is only in aqeedah and manhaj? Don't you think you need to follow the Prophet in the etiquettes and the way you deal with others? Don't you think if a woman, a sister, who's mutahajjib, who's wearing hijab, and there's some of the characters that you see from her, wallahi, it's ghareeb, it's ajeeb. It's something that's amazing. So we have to, brothers and sisters, follow the Prophet ﷺ in all of that. In the way we carry ourselves, the way we are, the way we talk, the way we act, all of it. Point number three. عَمَلُكَ الْيَوْمِ غَيْرَ الْمَفْرُوضَاتِ. Now the Sheikh moves on to the last and final one, which is your daily doings. Mm-hmm. Your daily doings. What you do daily. I think there's one more he finally mentions, which is طَرِيقَةُ طَالِبِ الْعِلْمَ, apart how to seek knowledge. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he now moves on to عَمَلُكَ الْيَوْمِ. What does a student of knowledge need to do daily? Point number three, okay. أَن تَكُونَ دَاعِيًا لِلسُنَّتِهِ, that you are a person who calls to his sunnah, نَاصِرًا لَهَا, and you give victory to the Prophet's sunnah, مُدَافِعًا عَنْهَا, and you defend the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى سَيَنْصُرُكَ بِقَدْرِ نَصْرِكَ لِشَرِيعَتِهِ, and Allah is going to give you victory as much as you give victory to his sunnah. If you give victory to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah will give you victory in accordance to the victory that you give to the sunnah of the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam. But what is it that the Shaykh first mentioned? First of all, let it be found in you. وَفَقَكَ اللَّهِ يَا عَبْدَ اللَّهِ. May Allah give you tawfiq and sadad. Let it be found in you. الْإِئْتِمَامُ بِهِ وَالْإِهْتِدَاءُ بِهَدِيهِ. You be in accordance to his guidance, in your mannerism, and in your ibadah and all of that, and the way you take his path. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah then says, then be a person who would not accept qayd ul-mula. This is a qayd ul-mula, this little finger, of anything being changed from his religion and the way of the Prophet. No one can add anything whilst you live. And no one can deduct from the Prophet's statements and his doings qayd ul-mula, this much. Don't accept it. Defend it. Because if you give victory to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and you help and aid it and support it, remember that's all going to come back for you. Al-jaza'u min jinsi al-amal. Allah will deal with you in the way you deal towards his religion. And the Prophet ﷺ, he told us ﷺ, that the people are three types. The Prophet told us this. La yazalu ta'ifati min ummati zahirina ala al-haqqi mansurin. The Prophet told us that people are three types. First people are the people who are ta'ifatul mansura, the victorious group who are given victory to the religion and they are being given victory to Allah, by Allah. That's the first group. Sah? That's ta'ifatul mansura. The second is what? لا تزال طائفة من أمتي ظاهرين على الحق لا يضرهم من خذلهم. A people who deceive them. A person who is meant to be from the Sunnah, who's deceiving you, who's pulling the plug on you. He's meant to be with you. He's infiltrating you. What is he doing? He's an infiltrator. He's deceiving you. He's lying to you. He's very what? He's very corruptive. And he's bringing about problems for you. He's mentioning your little shortcomings here or there. You did this, you said this. Khalam, mayan bali. It's a big agenda though. So he discriminates you. It's a deceptive individual. That's the second type of people. لا يضر. The Prophet told us, لا يضر من خذلهم. The one who does خذلان to them, he won't harm them. ولا من خالفهم. And the third one is مخالف, a person who is opposing him, does not in line with him, does not agree with him, does not respect him. لا يضرهم من خذلهم ولا من خالفهم. حتى يأتي أمر الله. Until the time of the hour comes, they won't be able to harm him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to what? Give that person victory. Now the Shaykh rahimahullah, he moves on to عملك اليومي, your daily doings. Your daily doings. That which are not obligatory. So the Shaykh is not going to mention things that are wajibat and mafrudat. He's only going to mention غير مفروضات. Things that are voluntary, that a person needs to do. And Shaykh Wallahi rahimahullah ta'ala, he has placed manhajan muharraran jameelan, a very beneficial and a very amazing methodology he places that a person of knowledge, a talib ilm, needs to take. The first one is, إِذَا قُمْتَ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ, when you stand up at night. فَذْكُرِ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى, remember Allah. وَادْعُ اللَّهَ بِمَا شِئْتَ, and call unto Allah and supplicate to Him بِمَا شِئْتَ, of whatever you want. فَإِنَّ الدُّعَاءَ, because supplication فِي هَذَا الْمَوْطِنِ, because the dua at this particular place, حَلِيٌّ بِالْإِجَابَةِ, is most likely going to be accepted. وَقْرَأْ قَوْلَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, and read the statement of Allah, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, read that, حَتَّى تَخْتِمَ, until you complete Surah Ali Imran, وَهِيَ عَشْرُ آيَاتٍ, and they are 10 verses. Read them. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he goes into here what is known as Qiyamul Layl, standing at night. This period of time that we're living in, it's rare you even come across a person who would pray Qiyamul Layl. Back in those days, it wasn't even seen to be a very virtuous person to pray Qiyamul Layl. It was lizam al talib al ilm. It was like you have to do, it's to-do list for a student of knowledge, that he prays Qiyamul Layl. And kathiran ma aqulu, brothers, a lot do I say that a person who doesn't have a portion of the night where they pray and they don't remember Allah at that time, does he really deserve the title of student of knowledge? Does he really deserve it? So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he mentions, but here there's an issue, which is that, and the scholars they used to dislike, is that the person, he shouldn't spend the whole night praying. The reason is because, as Imam al-Shatibi rahimahullah mentions, he said, كَرِهَ مَالِكَ إِحْيَاءَ اللَّيْلَةِ كُلِّهِ. that Imam Malik ibn Anas, he disliked Ihya al-Layl, to give life to the whole night, meaning stand up all night, kullah, all of it. وقال, he said, لعله يصبح مغلوبا, because it could happen that if he's praying all night, what's going to happen to you? You're going to be overcome for Fajr. The person may not, you might miss Fajr, or you might even be overcome at that time. So the person should try to stand up ثلث الليل الأخير, the last third of the night. The last third of the night. And pray and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah descends. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim, both narrated, يَنْزِلُ رَبُّنَا, our Lord descends, تَعَالَى كُلَّ لَيْلَةٍ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ الدُّنْيَا حِينَ يَبْقَى ثُلُثُ اللَّيْلِ الْأَخِيرِ. Allah descends. يَقُولُ, Allah says, مَنْ يَدْعُنِي, who's going to ask me, فَأَسْتَجِيبَ لَهُ, in which I will respond to him and give him what he wants. مَنْ يَسْأَلُنِي, who's going to ask me, فَأُعْطِيَ, give him what he wants. مَنْ يَسْتَغْفِرُنِي, who's going to ask me for forgiveness, فَأَغْفِرَ لَهُ, and I will ask forgiveness for him. So the time that the dua is accepted is now. And Imam Ibn Muflih in his kitab Adab al-Shar'iyyah, he mentions a story. He said, بَاتَ عِنْدَ الْإِمَامِ أَحْمَدِ, a man spent the night over with Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah. فَوَضَعَ عِنْدَهُمَا, Imam Ahmad placed water for this man in front of his place. قَالَ الرَّجُلُ, the man said, فَلَمْ أَقُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ, the man said, I didn't wake up at night. وَلَمْ أَسْتَعْمِلِ الْمَاءِ, and I didn't use the water. فَلَمَّا أَصْبَحْتُ قَالَ لِي, when I woke up in the morning, Ahmad said to me, لَا تَسْتَعْمِلِ الْمَاءِ, did you use the water? Some of the story mentions that Imam Ahmad, he brought him water before, after Isha. Ahmad went to sleep, prayed his qiyam, finished. When Fajr was close, Ahmad wanted to get him a new water. Why? Because he had to have used the first water for qiyam al-layl. And then the second water is for what? For Fajr. So he brought the second water. When he came and he brought the second water, he saw that the first water wasn't utilized and it wasn't used. And then Imam Ahmad said to him, when he saw that the water wasn't used, Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Imam Ahmad said, مَا سَمِعْتُ بِصَاحِبِ حَدِيثِ لَا يَقُومُ بِاللَّيْلِ. Ahmad said, I never heard a person who's seeking the knowledge of hadith and he doesn't pray at night. I've never heard that, Ahmad said.